gentlemen, and welcome to our second session for this year's 43rd annual Philosophy Theology Symposium. My name is John Trapani, and it's my pleasure to welcome you here this evening for our second session. Should there be any of you that may have been here last night, we had a wonderful session and evening last night. As during the week, we focus on the six great ideas. And last night, we had Drs. Vincenzo Beach and myself doing truth, goodness, and beauty. Those are the first of the six, the first three of the six great ideas. And tonight, we will be exploring the second three. What Mortimer Adler called ideas we live by. And these are liberty, equality, and justice. And so it's my pleasure right now to introduce to you the first of these presenters this evening. His name is Will Cooley. He's been at Walsh since, we're trying to guess, but it's somewhere 2008, 2009, so it's about a good 10 years by now. Without further ado, let me introduce to you Professor Dr. Will Cooley.
Thanks so much, John. It's an honor. The last Philosophy Theology Symposium under your watch, 43rd. And you invited us, that's great. I can tell you, I was talking to John before, and how long have I been at Walsh, and I can't remember, it's either 9 or 10 years. But I do know that almost without fail, when I run into a Walsh alum, they say, is John Trapani still there? And you know, it's gonna be kind of nice to say, no, yeah. Hop into the sunset.
Thanks a lot, Will. That didn't come out the way you meant.
No.
When you're gone.
It's an honor to be here. 43 years, that's really impressive. 44 years. 44 years, that's really impressive. Not many things last that long. So,
keeps getting worse.
I'll take myself out of the floor. All right. So, I got liberty. And I read Adler's chapters on these three great ideas, and a specific quote from his chapter on liberty stuck out to me, and you'll see this later on. And it raised this question for me: can there be liberty without work? And so Adler has three kinds of liberty. It's very Western idea, but three kinds of liberty that he identifies. Inherent, so this is the kind you're born with, human nature. Locke, Jefferson, he talks a lot about those two characters. That we earn, right, the acquired. Hopefully, students here at Walsh, you are acquiring this liberty through the moral virtue and wisdom. And then the circumstantial kind, the kind of situation. So you have liberty, but it's not complete liberty. He is not a libertarian, and he makes that clear throughout the chapter. Because he says all of these things rest on justice, and this is what Dr. Seaman will be talking about tonight, but even in his liberty chapter and in his equality chapter, he talks almost more about justice than he does either liberty or equality, because he thinks this is the key factor. I don't usually put a lot of words up on my slides, but I think this is important because this really gets at where he's coming from. So justice is the supreme value, a greater good than either liberty or equality. You can't have too much liberty because then you will trample on your neighbors, and you can't have too much equality because he argues that not everyone is equal. Liberty and equality can be maximized harmoniously only when the maximization is regulated by justice. Justice is his key to figuring out these other two ideas. And I was surprised how much he talks about economics in this chapter. And he rejects these two characters down here. He's a liberal, and he's looking for that middle way. He rejects Rand, Ayn Rand. He is not a libertarian. He makes this clear on several occasions. You can't trample on your neighbor, because then you run over your neighbor's liberty. You can't exploit people, because that's not justice. He rejects Marx, because he says, we don't contribute all the same. We're not do all the same, because we don't contribute all the same. Some contribute less, some contribute more. And so he says, in gentler ways, but he rejects Marx and says, no, this is not justice either, because justice would give us what we contribute instead of just giving everyone equal shares. So there's a lot of discussions of economics, and that's when it becomes even more interesting in the world we're heading into. Now, not everybody agrees with these numbers. Not everyone agrees that it's this high, that we're headed towards a AI revolution, a robotics revolution. But I notice that even the people that say, no, they're too high, they don't say they're off by much. We're headed towards a situation, and many of you have seen this already, and you know it's happening. I've taken my students here from Walsh on a tour of the Timken facility. It just got built here in Canada, and it's amazing. It's a wonder. They dug down so deep they hit groundwater. And you tour this facility, and what don't you see? Workers. It is almost completely automated. It is a massive expansion of that facility, and you never see workers. Once in a while, you'll see maybe an electrician go through and try to fix something, or a robotics technician, but there are no traditional steel workers in that facility. And it's just not steel work. We're about to get hit by a wave of automation in a lot of jobs. That's interesting, of course Adler couldn't have predicted that, but it's interesting, and again, I'm putting a lot of words up here, but this is the quote that really stuck out to me from Adler. Welfare payments received by those who are both able and willing to earn a living, but cannot do so because they are unemployed through no fault of their own, make them dependents in the way that children are. And that's my own emphasis right there. This is an indignity that no adult human being should be forced to suffer. What are we going to do if there are no jobs for a large percentage of us? And I include history professor in this as well. I am not naive about what's coming for history professors. I've seen this. It's happened already. I talked to a friend at Hofstra. She said we had 12 history professors. We now have 4 history professors. I talked to friends at Toledo. They said we had 20 history professors. We now have 3 history professors. This is happening already. A lot of these things are going online. The world is changing. People are already outsourcing their grading. They're outsourcing all sorts of things. So a history professor would be one of these things that's going to be minimized, if not completely disappear. They are dependent in the way that children are. This is not a recipe for a society that values liberty. You're dependent in the way that children are. Strong language. And strong language that really taps into American history, whether he knew it or not, and I think he did, he's tapping into American history here. Why could only 15% of people vote in those first presidential elections after America got their independence? 15%. Who were they? Yes. White male landowners. And why? There's a lot of reasons. But the reason they gave is that these people are independent. They are not dependent on anyone. These are the only people we can trust with this country, because they're not dependent on anyone. They're not dependent on bosses. They're not dependent on husbands. They're not dependent on their owners. But of course, white males who had bosses White males who were not independent immediately started pushing for the right to vote, sometimes violently. And this triptych from this era shows this perfectly. These are men, and men that make this country. And notice how they are working. This is a triptych from the 1820s, 1830s. But the threats are already coming. The threats are coming in emancipated women carrying their lunch pails to work, a threat to their manhood, a threat to their jobs, and the threat of emancipated slaves to these white men. So these guys built their whole identity around being these independent men, even though they had bosses. They had to change that notion. And these were real Americans. These are not children. They are not dependent on other people. They are not dependent like women are dependent on their fathers and husbands. They are not dependent like African Americans are dependent on their masters. In fact, in the language that they would have used back then, what would have they called these people over here until they got married? Girls, right? Yeah. Chattel property, right? And of course, back then, women did turn over all their property to their husbands when they got married, right? These are girls, and it's still a derogatory term for black men. What are these over here? Boys. These are not men, these are children. Children, men. Adler uses that language in the way that children are. What happens when work disappears? We already have a history of this. We can trace this from the 1970s, when work disappears. This is the title of William Julius Wilson's famous work. What happens when work disappears? And we know from history that we start turning on each other pretty quickly. And we blame people for their poverty. And we go after people like this. This is an invented character, of course, but a useful invented character. The welfare queen. And we try to take away their liberty. She does not deserve her liberty. In fact, she deserves to be arrested because she is dependent. I'm worried when I see what happens to our society when work disappears. I could talk about William Julius Wilson's book, but instead I'm going to shift it to this one right here. This was an overlooked book. Those Who Work and Those Who Don't, Jennifer Sherman. 2009 it came out, sociological work. I think part of the reason it got overlooked because she was ahead of her time and people didn't realize it. 2009 is a little bit early to start panicking about what happens when work disappears. But she actually goes to one of these towns. It's a logging town in rural California. Work has disappeared. It used to be a thriving mill town, logging town. The work disappeared. The people are still there. She opens with a story of a criminal drug dealer. He's on supplemental Social Security income. He enjoys partying with his grown children as his pastime. And he loudly broadcasts himself as morally superior to welfare mothers and gays. The book goes downhill from there. The jobs are gone, but it's really interesting how work ethic remains so important in this town. It's a powerful, powerful norm. But now, instead of providing a decent life, it provides, quote, what she says, a sense of superiority to the economically inferior. This is the poor looking down on the very poor. She asks them, what does this mean? What does it mean to have a work ethic? And none of them can really come up with any sort of definition at all. But they know that they've got it, and their neighbor does not have it. They're turning on each other. The men in this town are a hot mess. When traditional routes to masculinity have been closed, the mills are gone, there's no more logging, many men engage in what she calls protest masculinity, which include misogyny, they are incredibly negative towards women. Gender distrust, they don't trust these women either, they think they're out to steal their jobs. And they actually discourage them from ambition. They refuse to accept responsibility for their own children. And they don't marry anymore. And marriage is just dissolved over this decade. The rate of single motherhood doubles. The poverty rate also doubles. It goes from a place that had poverty rate below the state average to above the state average in one decade. This is 1990-2000. Perhaps even worse are the many husbands who openly brag to her. She goes to these houses. She's an ethnographer. She goes to these houses. And they openly brag to her that, quote, I bring home the money, even though they don't. It drives their wives crazy. They're still wedded to this identity that they are the breadwinner, even though they haven't worked in years. And yet, when a visitor comes to the house, they say, oh yeah, I bring home the bacon. And they don't. It's the wife that's working often a double shift to provide for the family. Bizarrely, almost no one discusses economics in the entire town. When she goes and talks about why did this town hit the skids, no one discusses economics. Instead, they blame drugs, they blame welfare, and they blame alcohol. Economics is just out of the discussion. And they blame each other. An elementary teacher in this town claims that while her generation got the work ethic pounded into them, now she claims her elementary school kids to her, or her elementary school kids, her students, say, and this is her quote, I don't need to work. I'm just going to collect the check when I get out of school. I don't believe that teacher at all. I don't believe that her elementary school students are saying, I don't need to work, I'm just going to collect a check when I get out of school. If you could find me one elementary school kid in America that says that, I'll give you $20. I will. Right? I will give you $20 on the spot. If you can actually record a kid who says, no, I'm just going to be a welfare recipient. But in this teacher's mind, the next generation, of course, is ruining the whole situation. Never mind that the jobs have disappeared. Never mind that there's been economic ruin. She believes that the kids are now screwed up. And they are punitive. They are eager to punish each other for wrongdoing inside and outside their communities. Many are aware that locals had made ends meet for a long time by dealing drugs, but when she asks them, you know, where are the drugs coming from, they always point to outsiders bringing the drugs in, even though she's got several cases where she shows it's actually their own kids that are dealing drugs, or in some cases, their own husbands who are dealing drugs. They always blame the outsiders for bringing drugs in. It is an ugly picture of what life looks like without work. It also helps explain how California became the golden gulag. And of course, California had to start decarcerating only because the Supreme Court stepped in and said this violates the Eighth Amendment for cruel and unusual punishment, because you can't stack prisoners in unhealthy situations like this and see disease spread. California has an incarceration rate that shot so high that they were spending more money on prisons in California than they were on higher education. So finally the Supreme Court stepped in and said, you gotta start letting people out. But it helps to explain this. And there's been some pretty good studies by scholars showing that this drift towards mass incarceration starts happening in the 1970s. What else starts happening in the 1970s? The loss of work. And what did we do? Turned on each other. So if Adler is right, and these great ideas depend on economic justice, then we're going to have to revise some things. We're going to have to redefine these situations and stop looking down on people that don't have the same work ethic that we do. We're going to have to stop seeing people who are dependent as children, because a lot of us are going to be dependent. I hope I'm wrong in a way, but I don't see how this situation works out, And I'm looking at what sociologists have done, ethnographers have done when they go to these places that are without work. And that's what I'm seeing. And man, that was depressing. I got more depressing as I read it. So I'll let John, I'm going to field my own questions. All right. Questions?
Could you repeat the question so everyone can hear?
Sure. Why did it begin in the 1970s? I think there's a lot of factors, but some of it is corporations moving their jobs overseas, no doubt about it. With a process that had been starting, but then accelerated during the 1970s. There's also a shift in America from industrial capital to finance capital. And Judith Stein talks a lot about this, and I can't go into all the details, but there was a belief amongst a lot of people that finance capital was the future, service industries was the future, and we didn't really need those jobs as much as we did in the past. And so we didn't really form an industrial policy during this time as these jobs were leaving. It's only afterwards though when we started to realize that what's going to happen to places like Canton and Massillon when these jobs disappear. So I think there's a lot of factors, and then automation. There's a speed up in automation. I can see it in the Chicago newspapers that I looked at, starting in the late 60s and 1970s, where people start to realize, boy, my job is being replaced by automation. And that, of course, has sped up more and more. So I think there's a couple different factors that all kind of came together starting in the 1970s. But it was a long process. It was a very long process, and I think that's part of the reason we didn't really even notice it, because it was such a long process. I also think it's a natural feeling to say this is not going to happen to me. When we interviewed the Uber workers, I had Wall students interview the Uber workers, I was really surprised how many of them never saw it coming. At least in their minds, they never saw it coming. They thought that other companies might leave Northeast Ohio, but they never thought that Uber would leave Northeast Ohio. And maybe that's a natural human reaction.
I'm trying to balance your comments about the disappearance of jobs on the one hand,
yeah,
and a current low unemployment rate.
Yeah.
So people are working. Isn't the real issue here is that the good paying jobs, those that have what you would call the living wage,
right,
as opposed to the minimum wage, that those are the ones that have disappeared. So the woman you referred to working two jobs,
yeah,
to support her family, because that financial capital and the service industry has put people in the service industry, I'm thinking primarily of restaurants,
yeah,
and wait staff and cooks and,
yeah,
dishwashers. So the jobs are there. It's just not the good jobs, the good paid jobs. I wonder if you would comment.
Yeah. So the question was, is this really a matter of jobs disappearing or the shift to the service sector and low-end paying jobs? No doubt about it. How many of us have been driving around Northeast Ohio lately and have seen a sign at McDonald's that says, now paying $8.50 an hour? Like they are so proud of $8.50 an hour. We had a speaker on campus, Kellen, were you there, the Strengthening Stark?
Yeah.
And he was actually saying that he goes to some of these firms and they say, we pay $10 an hour here. What's wrong with people? Why aren't they taking these jobs, right? And he has to say, you understand what $10 an hour is? I mean, I've been at Walsh for a long time now. When I worked landscaping 15 years ago, I was making $10 an hour. What does that tell you about the stagnation of wages? Men's wages in America, on average, have not gone up since the 1970s. Men's wages in America, on average, if we take the median wage, has not gone up since the 1970s. The only thing that saved us is that women entered the workforce and our housing values went up for a long time, right? And the credit revolution, where you put everything on credit. So that's the only thing that saved us, and of course that popped in 2007. But I do think that there is still something to be said, John, that a lot of those service sector jobs are going to disappear as well. And part of the reason they can keep wages low is that they are headed towards just getting rid of those jobs completely. So they're getting rid of jobs at Giant Eagle. McDonald's dream is to just get rid of workers completely, right? You just do a self-checkout type thing. And so a lot of those jobs are going to disappear as well. There's also a spatial mismatch. So these workers in this isolated area in California that she's talking about, they don't have access to a lot of those service sector jobs. And you know, something we talked about in that Strengthening Start, how many people have just said, you should leave Canton? And we've heard this from the National Review, get up and leave Canton. We've heard this from the New York Times, get up and leave Canton. So it's a funny right-left agreement that the only solution is to leave Canton and go to places where they need workers, right? So I think you're very right. Service sector did not keep up. But I still think this problem is the looming issue that they're going to just get rid of a lot of these jobs, right? Amy.
Do you think that a guaranteed basic income more alleviates some of these issues, or is it like the work itself that is central?
Yeah. And we're going to have serious discussions, grown-up discussions about guaranteed basic income coming up here. And one of the things that we have to get rid of is this notion that if you're on a guaranteed basic income, you are dependent or a child. And maybe we will, because we've seen this in the past in the way that discussions of unemployment in the 1930s changed. When unemployment reached 25% during the Great Depression in America, when it was everybody in that line, unemployment line, all of a sudden discussion of government dependency changed. And we got Social Security, we got the right to unionize, we got all these government programs, and very few people, in fact, now people, Social Security and Medicare and Medicaid are like, get your government hands off my Social Security. They don't even think of it as a government program anymore. It's just their program, right? So maybe if work disappears at these rates, we can have this grown-up discussion and say, is everybody familiar with guaranteed basic income, right? That the redistribution from the top to the bottom and pay everybody, let's say, what have you seen, Amy? $10,000 a year?
$5,000
a year.
So very low.
Yeah.
But
you just, and that's just your basic income, right?
What they found with that, Canada did it, and this is Kate Paulson, this article that you used,
yes.
And everybody thinks welfare queen. People used it to start businesses,
right.
They used it to finish degrees,
yeah.
And they were really surprised by the positive uses of that.
Yeah, and there's been some studies about what people do when they don't have work, right? And I'm not encouraged. I like that, but when they don't have work, I'm not encouraged because they're mostly spending time online. It seems. So they're not. Remember Marx said, we're going to hunt in the morning, fish in the afternoon, and sip cognac in the evening, right? We're going to finally do the things we want to do, and instead, it seems like we're spending a lot of time online on Facebook. That makes us stressed out. So we'd have to find other things to do with our time too when it's not occupied by work. So,
yeah. Oh yeah, I was just wondering for that, as they're finishing degrees, starting businesses, etc. But then they get their degree, but then there's still no work for them to go.
Right.
So then what?
But then we'd have to change. The point of your life is not to work, but it's to actually have human flourishing. Do the things you want to do instead of the things you have to do, right? Maybe go to a 20-hour work week, maybe go to a 10-hour work week, whatever it is, to spread the work, and then hopefully that time gets filled with stuff that you actually want to do.
But I want to eat and I need money for that.
Yeah, so then we'd have to raise the universal basic income again, right? And let's not pretend that there's not enough money to go around. It's just distributed upwards right now, right? I mean, the Obama recovery was the first recovery where the bottom 90% lost money. That's why people were so angry. That's part of the reason people were so angry is that the the recovery post post-recession, it all went to the top 10%, and the bottom 90% actually lost money during a time of economic recovery. That's never happened before in American history. When the economy recovers, at least some of it went to the bottom 90%. Oops, right? This it all went to the top.
There are jobs available, highly skilled jobs, that people are not educated enough or well enough to train to apply for those. Engineering and technical work and so forth. And yet we have a large number of students who are going into fields that really have not much promise of paying a living wage.
Right.
And so this comes back to the education institutions to somewhere along the way with some guidance, I would say, to young people about being wise and choosing the field that they wish to pursue.
Yeah.
You can't put it all on government and policies in that regard without taking some accountability for your own behavior and your own choices. And education institutions
Yeah. So the question was, do we have a skills mismatch right now? But the problem is, we're not funneling people into the jobs of the future. We're funneling people into the jobs that don't pay well, right? And there perhaps is some truth to this. I'm doubtful. I think skills mismatch is mostly overblown. I keep hearing this, that there's all these jobs available for high-paid people. For instance, welders. Welders came up at our meeting, right? We need all these welders. But why isn't the wage for welders going sky high? And he said, well, he talked to the employers, and we're not training the right type of welders. Well, how long does it take to turn a regular welder into this other type of welder? I just don't believe that there is that skills mismatch that they're making this out to be. And there's plenty of data. If you just go on Google and say, does the skills mismatch actually exist? And there's just not a whole lot of data out there. The other thing is that, you know, everybody says, go into STEM. Go look at those STEM reports. And it's actually, we're producing in America right now more science, technology, engineering, math students than our market can bear. We are overvalued in STEM. Chip, one more question there? Yeah, one more question.
That's
right. I'm a registered nurse.
Yeah.
I'm going through the nurse educator program here.
Wonderful.
Okay. If there is a mismatch, we have a lack of nurse educators, we have a lack of nurses.
Yeah.
We are going to have a crisis because baby boomers are getting older,
right,
and we do not have enough nurses for them. So it is absolutely true that there is a mismatch. Women's studies is going to make nothing, but a nurse will make a fairly good wage.
Yeah.
And I've talked to people who know welders, and a welder can make as much as a registered nurse.
Right. I'm skeptical, I'm sorry. We'll have to look at the data, but I walked a picket line with the Massillon nurses recently, about a year ago, and of course they just closed that hospital in Massillon, right? Another blow to our community, which was closed by a corporation far, far from Massillon. And those nurses didn't feel like they were getting treated like there was any sort of shortage. In fact, they kept on trying to cut the number of nurses rather than add new nurses. If nursing is so needed, and we live in a capitalist society, why aren't the wages for nurses going?
We don't live in a capitalist society. It's been muddled up with part socialism for the past 40, 50 years.
Okay, so why aren't nurses' salaries going up if we have a shortage?
They are. If you go to the right hospital, they are going up. I've been at my hospital since 2014, and I've had 3 raises.
Great, wonderful. So that's
so
another thing, right?
It depends on your hospital. If you're not going to a good hospital, if you're not in a good place, you're not going to get a raise. But if you're in a good place, you're going to.
Yeah, and that speaks to what Dr. Chaprani got at. Leave. Right? Leave Massillon. Massillon's hospital is closing. So you have to go to a different hospital, perhaps the Cleveland Clinic, which is kind of frightening, too, that they're buying up all these hospitals. Because that, of course, that will lower. We had a former student here, I just talked to her the other day, and she said, Cleveland Clinic does 2 things. They're buying up all these hospitals, which is great because they're a world-class institution. But then, of course, wages come down because they say, go ahead, leave Cleveland Clinic.
we're going to buy your hospital next week, right? And then drive wages down. So we have massive corporate consolidation. Anybody tried to get an airline? I tried to get a flight out of Northeast Ohio to Phoenix the other day. Good luck. Right? Four airlines left that have about 80% of the business. I'm not comfortable with that. I don't want to tell people in Massillon to leave. I don't. I think these communities are worth saving. I think Walsh is worth saving. I think Canton is worth saving. I think community brings us together. And I'm not going to tell everyone, move to Nashville so you can get a better job. For one thing, what's Nashville going to cost to live in a place like Nashville? I was just in Charleston last week. It's blowing up. People are moving to Charleston like crazy. But of course, people who can afford to live there are the ones coming there. People who can't are being pushed out. I was in Durham, North Carolina before I went there. Durham has exploded. They've remodeled themselves around Duke University after losing all the tobacco factories. While they've exploded, the poverty level actually went up in Durham. And affordable housing might be a thing of the past in a place like that. So we can't all move to Durham. We can't all move to Charleston. I think Massillon and Canton are worth saving. We're going to have to do something different. Last one.
Thank you. Well, thank you very much, Dr. Cooley. And, as I get ready to introduce our next speaker, I want to make a comment real fast. From last night, when I had the opportunity, and I did mention this last evening, when I had the opportunity to hear presentations from two of my colleagues, and yes, I am in my 44th year, and I had never heard either of them in a public setting with a public presentation. Now the same thing goes for Dr. Cooley, and thank you very much. It was absolutely delightful.